Okay, well, the point of my interview is, one, it's for the San Jose Mercury News Sunday Magazine West, which I don't know if you've ever seen.
I've seen it, yeah.
But it's undergone a renovation towards the
Do they have printing in it now?
Concepts, everything.
Gosh.
And I've been writing mainly humor for them for the last year or so, and they I must say, pay very well, which is a tremendous
attraction. That's good. That's good. I'm glad to hear writers getting paid good.
But, you know, as a Berkeley writer, it's San Jose is a little of a strange world.
But you don't get down there
me.
Much. Yeah, it is a strange world.
And I never did. I mean, I had, there was a
neither
time
did
I had some friends there, but that was it. Anyway, so let me let you know that even though I live in Berkeley, I'm trying to pretend like I'm a Sunnyvale person.
Okay, well, I'll get into talking for lowriders.
Right.
Hey, man, no, boss Jordan, man.
And I also feel like I have to confess that I'm a musical idiot. So if I say things that
don't feel like the Lone Ranger. I feel like one frequently.
Good. Okay.
About the second chorus usually.
But first question, Mr. Garcia,
yes.
is where are you from?
I'm from San Francisco.
Is that what you think of as your home?
Yeah, that's where I was born, and that's where I think I was formed mostly. I mean, my opinions and my tastes and
at some point, though, you did...
Well, I also then feel like, in a larger sense, I feel like a Bay Area person. We moved to the peninsula in that furious rush that people had in the 50s to get the kids out of the city. Sort of a half-hearted attempt by my mom. We went down to the peninsula where we stayed for...
What were you doing that she wanted to get you...
I was being a kid in San Francisco, you know. I mean, I was 10, you know, or something
right.
like that.
Well,
and
what could you have done at 10?
Lots. Lots. And I had an older brother, too, you know, who was probably a little closer to the edge than I was, probably.
But I've read in other interviews with you that you said you were becoming a hoodlum.
I was sure. Well, I was. I later became a hoodlum. I wasn't just becoming a hoodlum, you know. At 10, everybody was becoming a hoodlum. I just had this brief hiatus, you know, down in on the peninsula where things were very different. And that, let's see, I guess we stayed there. When we went there, I was in the sixth grade. When we left, I had gone through the eighth grade twice. We came back up to the city, so that was about 4 years or something like that, 4 or 5 years maybe down there.
Why did you repeat the eighth grade? What did you do? Did you not do any of your work?
Or? Yeah. Uh-huh. I was too smart for school.
Uh-huh.
I knew it. I don't know why everybody else didn't know it. You know?
Do you remember the name of the school?
Sure, Menlo Oaks. Yeah.
And what does a 12-year-old... You were about 12? What
I know. I was older than that, 13, 14, I'd say, you know, 8th grade, whatever.
What did you do instead of go to school?
I went to school. I just didn't do any work. That was the point. It wasn't I didn't have anything in school or even learning. The point was that I was reading things, and I had my own education, my own program going. And I was really, really bored with school. It was a context I already had things decided for myself. You know, I had things that I wanted to do. I had plans, you know, and I had stuff going, and I had my own interests and my own rate of learning, which I just couldn't see slowing down or stopping and wasting my time with schoolwork.
Did you resent the move?
I didn't care one way or another. Not really. No, it didn't matter. It was kind of interesting for a few years socially. You know, it was very different. Well, down on the peninsula, in San Francisco, the school that I went to in the neighborhood that I grew up in was very Catholic. Down on the peninsula, Catholics were in the minority, and I was surprised to learn there were other religions.
Uh-huh.
That was a big surprise, you know. Oh, that's interesting, and whole other ways of doing things, and all, and also the whole thing of boys and girls was much easier, you know. In the city, everything was like very. Boys and girls were like two different worlds. They really didn't see each other, almost, you know. Even though we were in school together and everything like that, there was no social context in which anything to happen. But down in the peninsula, everything was there were these things happening already built in. Schools had dances, and all this stuff was part of a kind of a socializing program of some kind.
Do you remember your house there?
Yeah, it was a ranch style. It was a new ranch style, you know, 50s house.
This was like 1954, the height
right,
of
54.
Eisenhower
absolutely.
American
That's
dream.
Right, and my mom was doing good. She had a lot of money. She scored good. And that was the thrust of her thinking, you know, was to get out of the city. Mm-hmm. And so there we went to Menlo Park, you know, a real nice, which was just, you know, bursting out of the ground at that point, you know. Everything was new there.
When I looked at... You know, and I read all these books and interviews that you've given. When I looked at them, it struck me that in some way you were a very typical Californian.
Very typical.
You know, kind of moving up and around, track.
Absolutely. I think that probably, well, except that I had a long period of time. See, before my mom took me down to the peninsula, I was raised, if I could call it that, by my grandparents, and who left me largely unsupervised. I think that probably ruined me for everything, you know what I mean?
Or made you what you are today.
Or made me what I am today. My grandmother was a great person, but they were both working, they were both people who worked, and grandparently, you know, they didn't have much stomach for discipline. So I was pretty much unsupervised, and I was used to having things exactly like I wanted them, you know. I mean, I was used to getting up and doing things, doing what I wanted, coming in when I wanted, and going where I wanted, and not asking anybody if they cared, you know. And that was really, and I was much too much that person by the time my mom tried to get us down to the suburbs, you know. It was really too late. But the change did me a lot of good for other reasons. And also I had incredible luck with the teachers. I had a couple of teachers that really opened up the world for me. I was a reader, luckily, because I was sickly as a kid. I had asthma and didn't move much, you know. And because I couldn't, and because I spent so much time in bed and sick and at home, I read. That was my entertainment. That gave me a big, that was... separated me a lot from everybody else. And then when I got down to the peninsula, I had a couple of teachers that were very, very radical. I mean, they were absolutely far out. And I was lucky there. That's dumb luck stuff. You know, it isn't something that you, you know. And also being close to Stanford turned out to be a boon, too, because Stanford had lots of educational experiments going on, and they used the public schools around, you know, so there were lots of these fast learner programs and that sort of thing, and I was in all of those, you know, all the things that... So I sort of had this advantage of this kind of elaborate and accelerated... programs of various sorts in school, and a couple of far out teachers who were willing to answer any questions and turn me on to where to go. You know, if you want to find more out, you know, this is what you read. You know,
you mentioned that in other interviews, a teacher who turned you on to the book 1984.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, that teacher turned me on to lots of things, but that was typical. I mean, that was like the sort of thing that started me think. That was the sort of thing that started me thinking about social matters, which I hadn't. I mean, I was blind to anything like that before that. You know, that was very simple, of course, but. But it was a start, you know. I mean, that opened the door. All of a sudden, to know that there was that kind of thinking going on, you know, meant a lot to me at that time. Mm-hmm. And I was hungry, you know. I was really hungry. As soon as I saw that there were other notions, that was just a tremendous news. So me and a few other kids, there were two or three of us maybe in this this class that one class that. Right away, we were gone. You know, we were completely in another world. You know,
this was just after your father died.
No, this is my father died when I was very young. He died when I was 5, 4, right around there.
Well, that young.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
Yeah.
So you don't remember him?
Oh yeah, I do. I remember, and that in fact, that emotionally crippled me for a long time. I mean, I couldn't even stand to hear about it, you know, or anything like that until I was about 10 or 11, mm-hmm. I'd say. I mean, I didn't start really getting over it, you know. Although I can't say I remember him, the effect it had on me was really, it was really crushing. I think maybe because it affected my mother a lot, you know.
Yeah.
And I sort of, I could see, you know, I sensed that, you know. And And also, it was something that I wasn't allowed to participate in, and I think now that was really a problem, you know? Mm-hmm. I should have been able to...
They tried to just hush it up for me.
Sort of. They tried to protect me from it.
To talk about it.
Yeah.
She couldn't talk to you about it.
Yeah, no, she couldn't. She was... it really was painful for her. And that was the reason I went to live with my grandparents. It was after my father died.
Do you remember him playing?
A little bit, yeah. I remember he played a little of breaking out the clarinet, you know.
What kind of music?
Oh, like little. I don't know what the tunes were, you know. Except that I do remember like Stephen Foster kind of tunes, you know, nice little melodies and stuff like that, you know.
That's interesting because the way I happen to. Or Dennis noticed a piece I'd written about going to your concert at the Greek Theater, and it was just a fluke that I went. And
uh-huh.
After I wrote about it, a deadhead sent me a tape of the concert I went to, and I listened, and I thought about what I really responded to in your music was what I call a longing for home, or
it's in there.
A very American Stephen Foster.
American as apple pie.
Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah.
And
right.
So that's the kind of music you think of if you think of your father playing.
Well, not really. I don't have a picture of him as a musician, unfortunately. Apparently, he was a jazz musician. You know, so I mean, I wish I did. I wish I knew. I wish I could hear him play. You know, I think I'd be interested in it. But he was. He was hip for his day, apparently, you know. And I've looked at some of the arrangements that his band played. I remember poking around and looking at them, and I thought they were pretty hip. Of course, at the time, I really didn't, you know. It's something I'd like to have been able to do. I'd like to have been able to experience his music. But he was a musician who was interested in American music also. I mean, that was the kind of... He wasn't a classical musician. He was you know, a genre player like I am, I would say, you know, an idiom player. Yeah. And the clarinet is a wonderful instrument. It's got a nice sonorous... I remember the sound of the clarinet more than the tunes, you know what I mean? The clarinet has the nice woody... Yeah, it has a lovely quality, you know, especially in that middle, that relaxed register, you know, its middle register is very lovely quality, and it has a... And that sound is very present in my ear. I can recall it. Sounds linger in my ear. I can recall them, you know what I mean? Like some people can recall smells or something like that, you know? Mm-hmm. I can recall specific sounds, and I can hear a sound and it'll... I can, you know, all of a sudden it'll transport me to places, you know what I mean? And I can also recall them, you know?
Memory.
Yeah, very much so. And for me, that clarinet, I mean, I can just... All I have to do is go, there it is, you know, I can hear it right now. You know, that's that clarinet sound. It's right there.
So do you consider that Menlo Park experience is a part of your roots?
Oh, definitely. It's part of my directionality,
What have contributed to your life?
A sort of self-affirmation. And the sense that there are radical possibilities, you know, and other kinds of lifestyle things, lots of things, really. But there are things that the seeds were... For those, you know, for me to appreciate that, really, I was set up for it earlier on in San Francisco because I lucked out when I had a few teachers when I was younger. Yet, too, or that, and the teachers that liked me responded to. I was a good draftsman. I could draw pretty well. You know, I had some artistic talent, and the teachers responded to that. You know. And so I was encouraged along those lines. So those things as a whole, you know, it gave me a sort of a way to think about myself, you know. So I and my intention really, I'm not a schooled musician. I didn't study music as a kid.
Mm-hmm. Lessons?
No, art was the direction that I was going in, you know, conscious, that's where I was going in my mind, you know. And as far as, you know, what are you going to be when you grow up on? I'm gonna be an artist, you know. That was the direction that I was going in,
okay.
And experience the peninsula sort of nailed that down for me real well. It gave me a sense of self, a real good sense
of
self.
Do you think of yourself now as an artist?
I know the name, Lee Hildebrand.
Very nice guy too, you know, a saint. Anyway, okay, Dana Morgan, and now, what about the first acid test? Were you there for that?
The first acid test, the one at Big Nig's house in San Jose?
San Jose, yes. Now, this is,
yes, I was
this
there.
Is a great moment of San Jose history that San Joseans
yeah,
right. ought to know about. I think
Big Nig's house.
Can you tell me about, where was this?
Big Nig's house.
Big Nig.
Big
okay.
Nig.
Can you describe?
It was just a house, somebody's house, you know.
Known as Big Nig.
Big Nig, right, they called him. We brought all our gear down there, you know, we were freshly unemployed, you know, we finally got out of our bar gig and we were good and burnt out, you know, on the bars, but we were playing well, you know, we were playing good. We set up all our snazzy rock and roll stuff and the Praisers had all their funky weird stuff set up on the other side of the room, this all in the living room, you know. We cranked up, you know, for about 10 minutes we went completely hog bananas wild, you know. Then we took everything down and packed it up and went home.
Who were the other musicians?
The Pranksters, you know,
Kizzy
and the Kiz Gang, you know.
Uh-huh.
And for me, they were very funny to me at that time, you know.
Why?
Well, because it was like their whole thing, all their equipment and stuff like that, it was all so tremendously funky, you know. And they were so incredibly slapdash with it, you know. And they didn't understand the first thing about the simplest stuff, you know. It was very funny to me to watch them bumble around with this stuff. Then I started to appreciate what they were doing with it, really, they were letting it work for them in kind of funny ways. But we totally blew their minds at that. I mean, we took their minds and ran with it, you know, so they fell in love with us immediately. They loved us after that. We scared them real bad.
Why? How?
Because we had this tremendous purpose. I mean, a really well-organized rock and roll band, you know, in the middle of their completely formlessness of these parties, really, which is what they originally were, you know. That kind of purpose, you know, is like, wow, it seems like the most powerful thing on earth, you know. You can't imagine. How do they do that? You know, it seems like magic, you know, it's like miraculous. And they were beside themselves with the appreciation, you know. I mean, when you're high, you love something that can take your mind and just run off of it, you know. It's something you appreciate. So that was the first time we were appreciated at that level.
Uh-huh. Who were you then?
We were the Warlocks.
You were the Warlocks.
Yeah, we were the Warlocks.
You were electric.
Oh yeah, we were really the present Grateful Dead. I mean, the same guys minus one, you know.
Mm-hmm. What about Magoo's Pizza
Parlor?
That's
the first place we played publicly.
Uh-huh. What do you remember about that?
It was pandemonium. The very first show we played was pandemonium, and it really hasn't changed much. It really was. It was so surprising. I couldn't believe it. You know, it was like a movie, you know. It's like one of those old rock and roll movies from the 50s.
Do you recall seeing any signs of the Silicon Valley budding?
Oh, sure. I knew lots of people that worked down there. Oh, yeah, sure.
It
was, there was already crossover. I mean, I knew guys that played mandolin and did circuit cards. You know what I mean? It was already employing people, you know.
You're not thinking of Marshall Leister, are you?
No, Marshall. Marshall Lester is way above, way beyond that. Marshall Lester is, magnum cum laude from Yale, you know. I mean,
right.
He's serious. You know?
Uh-huh.
He's real, real serious. No, I mean, there were other guys that were around, just around, you know.
So there was already some of that business was starting.
Oh, it was already well underway.
The
Silicon Valley was underway by that time.
By 1963?
Sure, well underway.
Uh-huh.
It was involved with slightly different stuff. I mean, it was mostly obscure government contracts, you know, defense contracts, missiles. Up, but the space thing was already happening, had been happening for some time, and there was still a lot of audio going on down there. You know, I mean, Ampex and 3M and all that kind of stuff.
Did that affect the direction you
Not
took
really.
In any way? That. You've mentioned someplace
so
that,
you
your,
can notice it.
That your music, that you've always had a love of having the most extraordinary sort of equipment. And
Yeah, that really originates probably more with Phil than with me. I mean, because I'm from folk music, you know, so I'm not so But Phil has always been a guy who really loves, I mean, he's like a guy who loves a fine car, you know what I mean? He's a guy who's
machine lover.
Yeah, yeah. He likes toys. Okay. He likes.
You don't consider yourself that way?
Not really. I'm not to that extent, no. What I know, I sort of learned from him, really. I mean, he's taught me a lot along those lines. He's taught me a lot about a lot of things, really, but that's one of the directions that, and also because he came at it from the level of, he had been a radio engineer and had also been involved in electronic music avant-garde, you know, end of the world compositions that were electronic in nature, so he was aware of oscilloscopes and audio oscillators.
Wait, go back and say the end of the world equipment. What do you mean?
It's a certain style of music. You know, I mean, it's just like the avant-garde of music. You know, modern music in the classical sense.
You mean like Steve Reich or?
Yeah, Steve Reich was a good friend of Phil's.
Is that right?
Yeah, we know Steve Reich.
Oh, is that right? Was he down in?
No, he was in San Francisco at that time, but he was around, like Phil, for example, was involved a little bit with the meme troupe, you know, and Steve Reich was one of the guys who was around composing stuff for the meme troupe, you know.
That.
Yeah, I mean,
he's just the darling of New York.
Yeah, right, he's an old friend of ours. Yeah, he's an old friend of ours, and it's like Steve Reich.
Uh-huh.
Well, Phil was another guy who was composing crazy music, you know. And he was from that world, of the world of the serious avant-garde of music, you know. And I was from folk music, he was from that world, you know.
Did that attract you in any way? That
Well, we both were involved with music, but Phil is one of those guys who loves music of any sort, you know, and he can appreciate anything. And when he first met me, he loved the sound of the guitar, you know. He said, wow, you should do some crazy, crazy things with that guitar, you know. I mean, he was appreciative, like a fan, you know. And when I found out, you know, when I went to visit him, I found him there with a, you know, orchestra scoring paper, you know, with a foci for three orchestras, you know what I mean? And he's writing it, you know, with no piano. I mean, he's picking the notes out of his head, you know. I mean, a guy with absolute pitch, I mean, that's intimidating, you know. Uh-huh. This is a guy who seriously knows music, you know what I mean? Uh-huh. I mean, Phil's musical education is, that guy is incredible, you know. So, I mean, I said, you're my kind of guy, you know. This guy thinks big, you know. He was great, you know, and we had great fun, you know, together. We both appreciated each other's stuff.
When the warlocks were getting going, did you think someday, you know, I'll really make a living?
I wanted to play great. I didn't care about making. Are you kidding? Making a living? Are you kidding? I was prepared to
You had artistic ambition.
I was prepared to support my music addiction. You know what I mean? I mean, if I had to pay for every bit of it, I'd gladly pay for it. You know what I mean? It's not that kind of thing for me. It's the idea of getting of being allowed to play, and not only that, but getting paid for it is like, what? You know, you mean you're going to pay me to do this? You know, it's, whoa, you know, that's like a whole new ball game, you know, that's incredible. I mean, I've been playing for years for nothing, you know, mm-hmm. and next to nothing, and God, I'd be the last person in the world to complain about it. I was delighted to be able to do it, you know. I mean, for me, music is something I love, not something, you know what I mean? I never thought ever to make money at it. I mean, what did I need money for? You know, really. I mean, I was living great without any money at all. I mean, it was easy, really easy.
You talked elsewhere about sponging off.
Oh, sure.
All the rich people and
well, it wasn't hard, and they didn't have to be very rich, and I didn't sponge much off of anybody. You know, I mean, it didn't hurt anybody. Mm-hmm. You know,
you used a great phrase that you referred to yourself as the beatnik hordes.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah, right. You know, I mean, and it was okay. You know, it worked out okay. I was perfectly happy. You know?
You talked about the co-eds and the professors' daughters being generous.
No, they kept me alive. You know, uh-huh. They were great. I mean, really. You know, I they kept me going, and they were very nice about it to boot.
10? Okay.
Minutes. As in, I can smell the food.
Yes.
10
did you see any contradiction at any point between your sort of hippie Mr. Natural orientation and the incredible equipment that you use?
Never. Well, I don't have that. First of all, I don't have a hippie, Mr. Hippie, Mr. Natural. I don't think of myself as that guy, you know. I just don't, you know.
Well, let's put it this way. You act natural. You don't come on the stage like a movie star or a rock star or something
right.
like that. You know, I mean, like I said, nobody can imagine you picking up the microphone. And
only because
like,
I'm too chicken shit.
Are you thinking shyness?
Yeah, oh, sure. It's uh-huh. certainly that. You know, I mean, it's stage fright to a certain extent.
You don't think of yourself as a hippie or...
Not really, you know.
I
think of myself as a beatnik if I think of myself as anything, you know.
Uh-huh.
I still relate to that me, you know. And for me,
how
the hardware
simple,
is just part of the changing, the parade of passing phenomena, you know what I mean? I don't own it. It doesn't own me, you know what I mean? It's just stuff, you know. And it's gone now anyway, you know. So it's a period of time that I was happy to move through, but I don't miss it, you know. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
I don't have that kind of possessions. I mean, stuff doesn't get me that way, you know? I'd rather have fun than stuff.
Since this is going to appear in a New Year's Eve edition of a magazine.
Oh, my God.
We're going to forget Halloween and
yep.
wind ourselves ahead.
Okay.
You know, obviously the Grateful Dead has had an incredible past, and people often talk to you about the past of the 60s and so forth. What about its future? What do you see?
Well, I'll tell you, from back there, I could never have predicted this. You know what I mean? It's already surpassed my expectations tenfold, you know, conservatively. You know, so I'm not prepared to predict, you know. I mean, to me, it looks like we're going to keep going for a while.
Uh-huh.
I mean, time is going to start playing some part someday, you know what I mean? You can't live forever.
How do you see yourself fitting into Reagan's America?
Very poorly.
Oh, no. But in a way, aren't you?
It's not working so well.
Yeah,
so
well,
I mean,
I don't know. It seems like you're doing
hey,
well.
I didn't fit that well in Reagan's California.
Ever.
Yeah, well... Yeah, but that's not his fault, you know. I mean.
Well, no, I think there's a link. Do you? to me, there, you know, that as people find themselves feeling, well, it go back.
I've often had the horrible suspicion that those of us who are out here on this fringe, going like this, are creating the moral majority over there, and they're going, you know. I mean, in my worst moments, I think thoughts like that, you know, so I'd rather not think that we're doing, you know, that we're...
That there's any relationship between us and them?
I'd rather not, but I know there must be, you know, because we represent poles, you know, and the pendulum swings between the poles, obviously, clearly, you know. I just don't like that guy, you know, Reagan. I mean, I didn't like his movies, and I don't like his politics, you know. I mean, what can I tell you?
Don't you think, in a sense, that he encourages a cult-like world that deadheads have... What do you think of the deadheads and their
They're people who want some excitement. You know, they want something to look forward to, and people who want to have some fun. And I don't... And if they want more than that, that's their business, you know. I mean, and it's probably that they want lots of things. They can't be pigeonholed. I don't think of them as a group. I don't think of them as a monolith. You know what I mean? I think of that because my experience with them shows that there's as many kinds of them as there are any other kind of humans. You know what
mm-hmm.
I mean? They tend to be humans, and the thing that ties them together is the Grateful Dead experience, which they invent in their own image, you know what I mean? They see it the way they want to see it, and it does for them what they want it to. And that's great, as far as I'm concerned, you know what I mean? I like everything wide open. I don't like things answered for you, you know? I don't like... I like everything with question marks hanging over them. I like everything changing, you know? I like everything with the ability to change. And nothing settled.
But don't you see in some way that we're returning to an era like the era that spawned Jerry
some
Garcia
of them are.
And,
yeah, some of them are,
made,
yeah.
You know, made places like the peninsula boom and made you feel like a freak who didn't fit in
I've never been that uncomfortable with the world, I tell you. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I could take it or leave it. It's just that I've always had stuff to do that was my own stuff to do, and it always seemed more important for me to pay attention to it than it did for me to pay attention to whatever the world was doing. You know what I mean? That's all. It's really pretty simple. It's not, I don't have some axe to grind or anything like that, or territory to claim or anything. I feel part of a small, tight, long-lived community that is also similarly purposeful. So, it's necessary now to fill in, you know,
to make something right,
to take up the slack.
World.
Yeah. It was like, and also there's the thing of a second chance, too. There's the thing of surviving an accident like that, which was really incredible, an accident.
Kind of a Grateful Dead.
Yeah, well, I was really awful happy to be alive, certainly.
Uh-huh.
I was a changed person.
The accident is profoundly affected.
Oh, yeah, yeah, sure. Yeah, there was three of us survivors, and we were all really profoundly affected, definitely, no question.
I get a very strong feeling when you talk about this is something that is
cosmic.
Powerful to you.
In fact, it affected our whole little community. You know, it was like a big.
But we're Americans. We live in cars. We're around accidents all the time. Everybody has had some brush. Why do you think this was so particular?
For me, there was something about it was at the very beginning. I was just getting to be good friends with this kid, you know, with Paul.
Uh-huh.
I mean, we didn't really know each other that well yet, but it's like the thing, you know how you know you're going to be good friends with somebody, you're just warming up a relationship.
Friendship
is just warming up. Yeah, it's just getting hot, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I could feel that coming. I mean, we were starting to cook, you know. I could feel that coming, and the loss there was the loss of potential, not so much the loss of a real thing. It was the loss of what might have happened, you know.
Uh-huh.
That's what really hurt. And for me, it really hurt. I can't explain why emotionally it was
maybe your
really important to me.
Loss of your father sensitized you to
conceivably, maybe
made you more sensitive than average.
I don't know. I hadn't thought about it. It's not something that was hanging out there. You know.
Do you think of yourself now, or did you think of yourself then as a particularly sensitive,
no,
artistic temperament, or just a
not temperamentally, no.
Uh-huh.
I think, in fact, I would think that I didn't think. I think of that as being one of my saving graces. You know, I mean, that I'm not that fragile. You know, and
mm-hmm.
that I'm not, and also that I'm not that self-absorbed.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It kind of
hasn't
it makes
all
it easier for me to give things up.
Adulation that you've received and these devoted, almost cult-like followers.
That's not me, you know. I mean, that's not about me, you know.
Uh-huh.
That's about it, you know. And it is something that's not me, you know. I participate in it, but so do they, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So they're entitled to feel that way about it.
Uh-huh.
You know? I feel that way about it myself.
You don't take it personally.
No, not at all.
Uh-huh.
I can't really.
Personal.
I'd like to be able to, but I don't.
Uh-huh.
You know, I mean, I can't say that I am responsible for it in that sense, you know.
The fact that there are people who would fight off security guards to get in your car, or who would just...
They're very polite about leaving.
To be
they didn't take anything, you know.
Right. Or just that they would love to be in this room, or, you know, will follow the band around.
No, that stuff is not...
How do you keep from thinking, hey, maybe I really am just...
Because I'll tell you why. Because the minute you try to go somewhere with any of that, in other words, the minute you try to capitalize on any of that phenomena, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It just turns to dust in your face. You know what I mean? It doesn't help. It doesn't do a thing. You know what I mean? When you get a flat tire on the road at night, you have to get out of the car and change it yourself. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like that stuff doesn't
help.
Yeah. None of that stuff does anything in any way affects who you are really. You know. And
when it first started happening, for
I was much too skeptical. I was much too cynical
to
worry about that kind of stuff. You know, no, it was never a problem. And besides, when it first, it never did first start happening that way. You see, I mean, for us, our whole first wave was basically that our audience was us. You know, I mean, our audience was the same as us, and
uh-huh.
nobody thought anything I was anybody special, you know. I mean, that didn't start happening until way late, you know. Uh-huh. So I didn't have to deal with that kind of stuff, you know, luckily, you know.
Let me throw out a few names for brief free associations from, you know, just like quick what comes to your mind when Tangent.
Tangent, yeah, right. Well, that was the top of the Tangent was the name of the folk music club in Palo Alto where I became the sort of bull moose goonie there, you know. I was the guy that sort of, I was the top guitar there, you know, I was the hot licks guy there, and the hot banjo there. Sort of my joint, you know. My turf.
That was your scene.
Yeah.
Boar's Head.
Well, the Boar's Head was up in San Carlos. That was kind of Rodney Albin and Pete Albin and those guys, their scene. And that was much... they're friends of ours. Pete Albin was the bass player in Big Brother and the Holy Company, as a matter of reference. Rodney Albin was a good friend of ours who just died recently of cancer. A nice, nice guy. Really, really sweet guy. We had a big a party for him, a benefit thing sort of in his memory not too long ago. It was really nice. And we met those people, the San Carlos people there, the little San Carlos people who were kind of like what we were down in Palo Alto. Mm-hmm. That was part of the networking of the hippie world, you know. I mean, uh-huh. What became the hippie world, you know, what became the Haight-Ashbury eventually, this is part of the early networking. You
Did
know?
You think of yourself
there was
as
the offstage.
Bohemians or...
Beatniks.
Beatniks.
We were Beatniks.
You were Beatniks.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about the offstage?
Well, the offstage was the San Jose version of the same thing.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So there were all these little... Were they places where people drank coffee more than booze or...
No, they took dope more than drank coffee or booze.
Would they take dope?
Smoke pot,
and then
you know, like
okay,
a soul pot.
Like smoke pot
yeah.
in the alley or in the car?
Yeah, in the alley of the car, you know, like that.
And then you'd come into the place and...
Nice and high, and play music.
Uh-huh.
You know, music, drugs, they go together.
And talk about?
Everything.
Talk about existentialism?
Well, the Palo Alto chapter did, because that was a sort of more literary chapter, but uh-huh. that wasn't by any means...
what would people be
more often it would be
in
goof. More than talk about subjects... Language became something where you goof. It's like music, you know, where you make
Tripping.
Things up. Yeah,
uh-huh.
It's fun, you know. I mean, it wasn't about let's say things to each other. It was about fuck me, fuck you, you know. It's funny, you know. It's like you know, game playing, you know,
uh-huh.
throwing language around. It's riffing, you know. It's a different thing. It doesn't have anything to do with content, you know. Content isn't germane. It's laughs count more than... You know.
Fun.
Yeah, fun. This all this stuff is under the heading of fun. Absolutely.
Uh-huh. Kepler's.
Well, Kepler's is a bookstore that had a little. They nicely provided little tables and coffee in there. You know, so you could hang out there. That was also my personal hangout. I hung out there days. That was my day job. Yeah, I practiced the guitar in Kepler's during the day, and read books. Great place, you know, and Roy Kepler was a sweet guy, and the guys that worked there, people there, all people I knew, and they were very, very nice to, they were very nice to me, they sort of treated me as a kind of for some reason they didn't throw me out, for which I'll always be profoundly grateful, you know, they were very nice to me, you know, they had some respect for me for some reason, I don't know why, God knows, I was certainly worthless, you know. But they were nice. They let me stay there, and let my friends come in and hang out too. So and that was sort of our, you know, that was the place everybody came to. You know, so at nighttime everybody would come there. If nobody had any money, everybody go to Kepler's. If anybody had money, we'd go to St. Michael's. Because Kepler's, you can stay in for nothing.
Uh-huh. Was there a cover at St. Michael's, or would they push you to buy something?
Cost a lot for coffee.
Uh-huh.
You had to have coffee. You had to order something. You know.
But the scene somehow moved out to the parking lot. Outside of
Kepler's? Well, Kepler's, the parking lot was active, sure, yeah, because, it was just...
Kepler didn't tolerate everybody the way it did you.
Well, the guys that worked there didn't frequently. A lot of times, I want him out, you know.
Uh-huh.
If somebody was too crazy or came in drunk or wrecked everything, you know, or got too boisterous or, you know, did that kind of stuff. Anybody got, you know, too up in the air, you know. So the parking lot was like where you go if you wanted to stretch out a little. That was just, That's like the California part of it, you know what I mean? Like, you can think of Kepler's as being the, inside Kepler's as being the Greenwich Village part of it, and from the parking lot to the beach, the California part of it.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
It's because
yes.
There is sort of a line of continuity from the parking lot to the beach, you know? Even though it's a long way, but all the space in between as well, you know what I mean? That was the California experience, which is wonderful, you know?
So, didn't a peace movement get started?
Well, that had already been in existence, and that had to do with Kepler's also, because that was it was sort of a hotbed of pacifism, you know, old style pacifism, you know, Bertrand Russell style nuclear disarmament, you know, that kind of stuff.
Ban the bomb.
Yeah, that's right. And there was a peace center.
That's back now.
Yeah, that's true.
That's
right. Joan Baez, for example, was an important local. Legend, you know.
Was she a friend of yours? Did you
not really.
Her
she was way above us, you know.
Uh-huh.
She was way above us, you know. She was off there in mythos land, you
Do
know.
Do you remember going to a concert she gave at Palo Alto High School in the summer of 61?
Summer of 61. No, I saw her. First I saw her was, it was probably around the summer of 61, but I saw her at Berkeley Community Theater was where I saw her.
That was the first time you saw her?
Yeah.
Do you remember going to see her at Palo Alto High School?
I don't think I ever saw her at Palo Alto High School.
A friend of mine went with you.
Really? Who is it?
Her name is Charlotte Daigle.
I know Charlotte Daigle.
I know you do.
Did she go to Russia?
Yes.
That Charlotte Daigle, yes.
Charlotte Daigle.
I had a tremendous crush on Charlotte Daigle for a while.
Oh, she'll be so happy to hear that. Charlotte,
oh, she knows. She knows.
No, she doesn't know.
Bullshit, I pursued her furiously.
She's a very modest person. Charlotte was my first roommate.
Really?
When I moved to San Francisco.
Oh, yeah, I was very aggressive. But I understand it was like a sort of a sensitive time in her life, you know. She was. I don't think she was ready to deal with somebody like me. You know, yeah, I guess maybe I did. Yeah, I did. I guess I did take
well,
her to a show.
She went back to try and see you several years later. Back
oh
again,
yeah, boy, that was
engaged.
That's too bad. I really had a. She was just lovely.
She was, and she is. I mean,
if you ever see her again.
Oh, I'll see her.
Give her my.
I grilled her.
Dearest regards.
Okay, well, she remembers.
So do I. I'll never forget Charlotte Daigle. Charlotte Daigle is somebody I really had a great crush on. I loved her really. Great. Beautiful
well, that's
person.
How it. See, now I wandered into San Francisco in 1965. This miserable person from New York.
Oh, that was a good just, year to hit town.
Just came in and advertised for roommate. Charlotte Daigle walked in, and the nicest person I've ever met. Just
yeah,
about, and
very
as,
sweet.
You know, as a roommate, I mean, you know,
yeah, good luck.
Is
what great luck.
Wonderful. You know, and I just thought. And then I went to San Francisco State, which
oh,
you know, when
yeah.
the year Jane Dornacker was homecoming queen.
Yeah, right.
I mean, it was just,
right.
It was
65 was a good year.
Yes.
In
yes. Oh yeah. When
she
Jane the Earth Mother is what she was called then. Anyway, so Charlotte told me the summer of 61. She had just graduated from Palo Alto High the year or two before. Joan Baez came back, and now she was a famous lady.
Right.
And Charlotte said she went with you, and you dragged her into the front row and sat there really intently saying things like, I can do that. I can beat her technique. And, you know, almost like dueling
guitar. That sounds
guitar.
Like me.
And
that sounds like me in 61, yeah.
You don't remember that, going to see her and feeling that.
Not really. But
competitive.
But I'll always remember Charlotte Daigle.
Is that
really?
Right?
Yes.
Oh God, she'll be
oh,
so
sure.
happy
she's,
to hear
she's
that.
Oh, sure, she's wonderful. Yeah. Oh,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
So Charlotte told me she hung out in the Kepler's. Now Charlotte got
yeah,
thrown
was one
out
of the
Kepler's.
At Kepler's. Yeah, she was.
She
at Kepler's.
Said they wouldn't let her stay past a.
Oh yeah, time. Maybe so. Yeah, possible. A lot of people did. A lot of people did. I probably got thrown out a few times myself.
She also remembered you talking about the accident. That's why I asked you. She remembered.
Yeah.
That she had assumed that the Grateful Dead referred to you from that
you know,
situation.
It doesn't, not on purpose,
uh-huh.
you know, but in a way, everything in my life sort of does, you know what I mean? I mean, in other words, that for me, that was one of those psychedelic occurrences that happen in your life. You know, those times when your life has a before and after quality, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the accident for me is one of those times, you know, I mean, my life since the accident I'm a different person since then, right?
Uh-huh.
I mean, that accident, I changed, you know, that was it, you know, I was different. The person who came out of the wreckage was not the same person who went roaring into it, you know, really, I mean, something.
Born again, or
yeah,
or
I was very definitely
or
somebody else,
something.
So I was a different person, you know, so that for me, it's like LSD, or like, you know, like, yeah, like any near miss, or anything like that, or any really powerful experience, that I'll never be the